afternoon. Hopefully everyone's still awake after lunch. As you said, my name's Grant McAllister. I'm an actual engineer. I try to do stuff at least, you know, 2 or 3 minutes a week. At least that's what my team thinks I do. But I work on the RDS service. I helped found it a few years ago. I think it's now like 7 or 8. Very happy to be here talking about Postgres. It's kind of my favorite engine. Spent a lot of my time on it. And this talk will kind of cover things that we have announced in the last year, including our Amazon Aurora, which I'll get to in a second, as well as some of the lessons we've learned helping customers run their databases on RDS. So let's jump right in. So as I said, one of the big announcements that we made in the last year was our own version of Postgres called Amazon Aurora with PostgreSQL compatibility. That's the official name. I don't call it that. I call it Aurora Postgres because I don't like to talk that much. But essentially what it is it's a Postgres 9.6 compatible engine. So on a wire, from a functionality perspective, it's going to behave exactly the same as RDS Postgres, same extensions, you know, everything will work the same. But the difference is that it's cloud optimized and it's log based. So that little picture over on the side is essentially showing you, well, that we've taken sort of the bottom half of the engine where normally Postgres writes to files and changed that into a log structured kind of storage mechanism. And I'll jump into a lot more details later on in the talk. One of the key benefits is that we do 6 copies across 3 availability zones, so a higher level of durability than we've been able to provide before. Up to 15 read replicas with very low latency on those. Faster failover down to less than 30 seconds. Enhanced scaling. Show you some performance numbers. And the other one of the cool ones is that it'll auto-scale your storage up to 64 terabytes without you having to go and add more storage or do any of that. So, like I said, I'll cover that as we get further into the talk. On the RDS Postgres front, we released support for 9.6 shortly after the community did. We're just prepping right now to get the new minor releases, 9.6.2, 9.5.6, and some of the older ones out, which includes some patches. But the other thing that we do when we release these is we actually typically add some new functionality. In this case, we added some extension support on both of the last minor releases. So Bloom Filter and PG Visibility, which were just core 9.6 extensions, we added support for those. In 9.6.2, we added this new one called LogFDW, and I'll get to that in a second because you've probably never heard of that one before. PG Hint Plan, which we had a lot of requests for, especially out of our Japanese customers. And PG Free Space Map, which again was a standard one that we just didn't have in the original one. So when we started, we had 32 extensions with RDS, and then we added a few more on 9.3, and then 39 on 9.4. 9.5 had 44, 9.6 now has 49. Now, in the future, we're going to have a lot more. And how do we decide on what a lot more is? Well, when people talk to us at conferences, they send it to this email mailing list. We basically look at those, and then we talk to folks, and we try to figure out what the priority is. So we've had lots of requests for things like PG Repack, PG Audit, just to name a few. So if those are things that are interesting to you, please let us know. Like, you can either come talk to us at the booth, send me emails, and you know, because that's what we do. We're trying to focus to make sure that we're trying to provide the extensions that we can. Now, we don't do unsafe extensions like PLPerl-U because of the management structure that we put around RDS. But anything that's not like that, there's no reason why we, you know, if we get enough customer demand, that we'll go execute on it. So the new one that we added, which we actually developed. And I say developed, it's kind of in quotes, because we took basically the file FDW and cut it down to make this thing called log FDW. And what it allows you to do is have database access to your Postgres error log. So if you set your log destination as CSV, right, and you go create this extension, just like you would any other ones, you create a server, basically you can select from list Postgres log files, and you get that nice list, and then you select the one you want, and you do the create foreign table for log file. And once you've done that, you can see, you can select stuff, right? So you can go now, real time, look at your logs and say, hey, you know, who is connect, like I turned on logging for connections, so I could see who is connecting to my database, for example, right? So this is just a different way than using our API method to get the Postgres error logs out, which, you know, for folks that have been using MySQL, this has kind of been a feature that they've had for a long time, and so we had a lot of requests to do something like that. So one of our developers basically just knocked this out. I actually had a question about this feature, even though we hadn't released it, by someone who said, hey, I heard you're doing this. What's the story? Do I have to use CSV log? I don't necessarily, you know, turn that on all the time. I said, no, you can do it without you just specify one of the log names. It's not a CSV log. The only thing is, of course, you get one really long line, right? You don't get any kind of parsing. But you can see in my select statement, I can still do likes where I can say, hey, show me something like connections. It's just going to, take a little more to get that out. The other one we added, like I said, that the Japanese customers really liked was PG Hint Plan. A lot of them are moving from Oracle today. They're moving to Postgres. You know, they've got an application where they're trying to get things to run and they're having a little bit of difficulty. So they wanted this extension. I'll show you sort of an example in a second. Once you load this, you have to add it to your shared preload libraries because it's that kind of extension. And then once you do, you'll see these extra GUC parameters, and I won't go through all of them, that you can set to basically control the behavior of this this extension. What does it look like in practice? Well, let's say you're doing an explain on PG Bench, which everybody does, and this is just a join between the two common tables. Normally, you're going to get this kind of explain, a hash join with a sequential scan. So nothing too complicated. Let's say you're like, I hate hash joins for some reason. And you're like, make it a nested loop, because that's better. Not really, but what you see is you can just put this hint in and say, I want to nest the loop on A and B, and now the planner is changing to do something else. So, obviously you got to, pick the right thing here, but it does allow you to override some behavior. Also allows you to set some different behaviors as far as GUCs inside of one query. So it's actually kind of a very powerful little extension. So that's going to be available in the latest miners for us. Oh, and that's just highlighted what I just said. Yay. One of the things, of course, our customers depend on us is to allow them to move up to new major versions. So we have a major version upgrade that you can do, showing sort of going from 9.5 here. We take a backup when you ask us to do this. We run PG upgrade, for those of you familiar with it. We take another backup, and then you get a production 9.6 instance. The reason why we take those two backups, for anyone that's not familiar with PG upgrade, it's not transactional. So there's no point in time during it, right? It basically is moving around data files and doing some really kind of squishy stuff that, you want to be able to say, hey, if it worked, great. If it didn't, I want to be able to go back to where I was, right? And this works on a lot of instances, but there's some really funny stuff that you can do, like defining views on a catalog schema that then change during a major version upgrade, and then PG upgrade kind of goes, I don't like that. I'm going to stop. So there are a few things. So that's why we recommend not doing this, but actually, of course, building a test instance, which is really easy because you just make a copy of your RDS instance, running through the whole thing again, running your application testing, making sure that works, and then going to do production, right? And this is one of the cool things about RDS is, doing this extra step will maybe, cost you 20 or 30 minutes of your time to go verify, outside of the application testing, that it's not going to break when you're going to do it to your production system. So obviously a big thing for our customers, especially you folks that, are in sort of the financial industry, security is a big deal. If you're coming from places like Oracle, this has been a bit of a richer system, at least at the database level. We've tried to sort of add pieces that allow you to do this at a lower cost. So we've got the typical application host, database instance, snapshots of your data, backups basically, plus your logs, right? We started by adding, first we had the security group that allowed you to control who could access the network. It was okay. Of course, we support SSL. And then we added the virtual private container cloud kind of thing, which is VPC, which really allows you to have things like ACLs and full network capabilities that actually is better than what most people run their own networks, which are typically very flat, to really control access. Then we added encryption at rest with a default key or our own key through our KMS system. So this is for your snapshots, your data files, your log backups, that's all protected. So at this point, it looks good, except for that then customers came back and said, well, when my people say SSL, mode disabled on their clients, does this. And now the encryption story is kind of gone, right? So we added an extra piece called new GUC called RDS Force SSL. When you turn that on by setting it to 1, it essentially causes now if someone sets this, they won't be able to connect to your database. So you can say to your auditors, look, I'm fully encrypted. No one's going to be able to talk to my database. No one's going to be able to look at my data. It's all good. So this was nice from a running database perspective. But we have cool features like snapshot sharing. And when we first launched this, it was for unencrypted stuff. Allows you to basically, share a snapshot with an account, and that person can make a snapshot of that, they can make an instance, they can even make a public one, right? It's all great, unless you, of course, needed to encrypt your data, and then none of this is applicable. So what we did was we rolled out encrypted snapshot sharing, which works similarly but slightly different, because now you have a key involved. Now, if you go to RDS, and this is one of the things, you know, we always kind of mess up a few things. One is that to make it easy, we made it so that you can do encryption at rest with a default key. You don't have to go create a key. The problem with that is when you talk about sharing things, since that default key may be shared, may be covering many, many items, we don't actually allow you when you say, I would like to share, it says, no. Because you may unintentionally be sharing a lot more things than you meant to by sharing that key out. So you actually have to go create a custom key, and that's what we recommend when you do encryption at rest with us, is to actually go ahead and spend the time to do your own custom key through KMS. So once you do that, there's basically a two-factor here. One is that you need to share that custom key, you add an external account to it, and then you actually need to share the snapshot. So you can actually divide the privileges up in your company and say, Bob has the ability to share snapshots, Steve has the ability to, you know, share the keys. And that way, you know, you don't have someone making a mistake of being like, oh, we just shared all our snapshots to, you know, our competitors. Oops. And once you've done that, it works exactly the same way that you can create snapshots or instances off of it. So this was good and well received. The next thing our customers wanted was they wanted this to work for our cross-region replication, so for DR purposes. So we're showing here kind of our classic configuration with our multi-AZ high availability. You can now, with an encrypted instance with a key, basically create a replica in another region, all fully encrypted, both, you know, on the wire and storage again, right? And if you go and promote that guy on the new region, it'll actually have its own independent key. So they are actually separated that way. The other big news that we announced in November was RDS Postgres becoming a HIPAA-eligible service. So we've had a lot of people in the healthcare industry really interested in, you know, using RDS that they couldn't before this. And the other one is that we have FedRAMP in our AWS GovCloud region for folks that need that as well. So those are, you know, sort of long time coming things that we need, you know, to get through the compliance stuff. Data movement's another one that a lot of customers are talking to us about, whether it's getting off of a current vendor that they're not happy with, or just moving data around between databases, which is kind of common now. We like to do that a lot. So a while back, we announced the data migration service, or DMS as I like to call it, because I actually don't like the M there, because I really think of it as a replication service that does migration. But you know, I don't win all the naming battles. So you can see all the engines that we support up top. And so these are, you can basically go from, let's say, Postgres to Postgres, or you can go Oracle to Postgres, or Postgres to Oracle. And I'll talk about the details there. But it's a really powerful tool in that it does change data capture. And so how does that work? Well, if you were doing a migration, for example, and you were on-premise, you know, or even in EC2, you could set this up, and you basically go and configure a database migration service instance, much like an RDS instance. You tell it what tables or what connection points you want, what's your source and destination, and then what tables you're going to use, and then you basically go do a full load. And this does a consistent select of all your data, sticks it in the new one, but the key thing that's next is that it does change data capture, then to pull from the logs and catch up. So that once you're caught up, all you got to do is stop writing on the customer premise side and switch over, right? So you can't, it's not zero downtime, but it's very short, right? We've had people do it in less than a minute. So how does this work? Well, you can be on-premise, you can be in EC2, and you can be in RDS for those versions that I specified. Now, it's 9.4 and above because we do use the logical replication capabilities of Postgres, the CDC there. So, you know, if you're on-premise and not at 9.4, then probably the thing to do is upgrade to 9.4 and then move in, right? As I said about the bulk copy, is a consistent select. And then we're just using the logical replication, and that's the URL for that team. And actually, we have one of their team members is here at the booth, so if you have other questions about this or some of the other stuff I talk about, he'd be happy to answer those. The other part that we heard from customers is they actually wanted to migrate from one engine to another. So we came up with this tool called the SCT, the Schema Conversion Tool. So it's a downloadable tool that you can use to go basically look at what it takes to convert from one engine to another. And what it can do, first of all, one of the cool things it can do is it can tell you how off you are in doing this, like how much work. So the green there, for example, is the stuff that's just going to transparently move over. The red stuff is on the far end where you're probably going to have to do some work with your application or change some major stuff to make it happen. So some people, you know, ask me, well, should I go to MySQL or Postgres when I'm coming from Oracle? I said, well, one of the things you can do is you can go run the SCT tool for both of those and see how much work it is for either engine. Most cases, Postgres being the richer engine, has less red on it, right? So that's kind of nice. In detail, like here, I don't know how well you can see this, but we have an Oracle procedure that we're moving to a Postgres function, and it would tell us, you know, it'll actually do the conversion for you once you get to that stage. The other thing is, as part of getting DMS to do logical replication support, we made generic logical replication support for RDS possible. So same versions that I talked about before. All you have to do is set this RDS logical replication parameter to 1, which basically changes the wall level to logical and a few other things. And then you got to create a slot so that you start capturing the data, and that's with that command. And then with pg-receive-logical, you can just start pulling the data. Now, there's getting to be all kinds of different ways to connect to this, like the JDBC driver does it now. I think Dave was saying maybe the Python one too. So this is kind of a new upcoming area. One of the things that is kind of odd today is that we only support the test decoding plugin. I'd be really happy to get any feedback now or later on about what other plugins people are interested in if they're thinking about using logical decoding. Now, how many people are familiar with logical decoding in Postgres? How many people know when you make a very, very large transaction that it has to be kind of assembled out on disk before it gets pulled to the other nodes? Yeah, couple. So one of the things that we did was we added a metric so that you could actually track this, because you might run out of disk space and you might not know why, and it's because you're basically, you know, materializing this thing from a physical wall to the logical, and so you can now monitor that as part of the RDS solution. And of course we have the normal replication lag metrics. And then the other one we added was, even though you're creating a slot for logical, it's just the same as a physical slot like we use for cross-region replication. And if you're not pulling, you're going to be using up additional disk space here. So we made another metric so that you could alarm on that in case someone's like creates a slot and forgets about it and you wonder why you run out of, you know, space on your database, right? Which is never a good thing. So one of the cool things is really talking about what you can do with this, right? So let's say you have an RDS Postgres instance. You can set up DMS and you can replicate to another RDS Postgres instance. You could replicate to Redshift. They actually have a very optimized loader for Redshift where it goes and does it in chunks, which is what Redshift likes as opposed to a single line insert. You could go back to on-premise. You can go to EC2. You could go to S3. We just announced this functionality for DMS. You can now do some portion of what you capture coming out of the change data capture into S3 directly. You could go to EC2 Oracle. We have some customers who are in the process of moving from Oracle to Postgres, but still have other Oracle databases that they need to fade data back to. So this is a way to do that. And of course, as I showed, you could have your own custom logical handler using pg-receive-log or the JDBC driver driving, let's say, a NoSQL database, right? And putting data in there. So one of the big lessons that we've seen working with customers is around vacuum, right? And this is one where how many people have ever had transaction ID wrap around on one of their databases? A few, right? It's not something you're gonna ever forget, because it's painful. What it forces you to do is to go into single user mode until you vacuum that table. And until then, guess what? You're down, right? This is not a good time for you. Your boss is probably gonna be in your office at that point, asking very difficult questions about why this happened. So there's a lot of parameters that you can set, and I won't go through this. I know NASB just did a talk on vacuum, and you know it's probably much more in-depth, so you know for the details on that. But for us, for RDS, one of the things that we noticed was we weren't giving enough information back to the customers so they could see all the vacuum, so we made some changes. The first one here was to allow logging of the vacuum commands, so you can now set the force auto-vacuum logging level. And this will now spit out things like this where it shows, well, we had to cancel an auto vacuuming task because of a lock not being available, right? So if this was the table that, you know, kept your transaction ID going up, you need to go kind of figure out why you have this locking problem, right? The other was seeing what auto vacuum was doing. Before you get this RDS admin is running that command, you'd get insufficient privilege. Now you actually see what auto vacuum it's running. So that's kind of helpful just if you're like, what's auto vacuum doing at the moment, right? But the big one that I really was actually really happy that the team came up with was this metric around maximum used transaction ID. And so this is out of the space that is the transaction ID space, right, that you have. It's you can see with now that we have this metric how fast it's growing by kind of the slope of the line and then how close you are to running out. And you can set alarms on this. Now, we monitor this ourselves. So if a customer gets way too close, we'll probably reach out to them and be like, there's a problem, because we don't want them to go into a single user mode situation, right? But from a general safety perspective, this has been really helpful because customers said, you know, yes, I could have monitored this, but now it's much easier. I like one click set an alarm on this, and if I hit a billion, you know, someone in my ops team is going to get a page about, you know, figuring out why we're not vacuuming and keeping up. So that was a big one around vacuum. So scale and availability is always a hot topic for a lot of our customers. I'd like to spend some time on that. One of the ones that we do on a regular basis is we introduce new instance classes. And this is just showing the M4. Now, I just picked the M4 large. It's kind of one of the smaller ones. And I ran PG bench read only, all in memory, just to kind of show the CPU power that you're getting. Transactions per second on the vertical axis. Larger is better, right? Blue is the old M3 large. Green's the new one. And as you can see, we get better performance with the new one. And that, you know, that's good, right? It's the 37% increase. But the cool thing is, it's actually a cheaper instance class. So your, you know, price performance is actually increasing. So this is kind of the regular cycle that you see with us, is that we, you know, keep doing new instances. And it's funny because, you know, my goal is to have you on the latest instance. I actually don't want to support all the old ones. I'd like everybody on the new one. So I'm always happy that we're doing this stuff, right? And with Aurora, we'll be starting with the R4s, and you'll see those roll out as well across the fleet over time. One of the other things that we had around sort of performance was customers saying, you know, I like the idea of RDS, but man, I really like being able to touch the metal. I like being able to run top. I like being able to run SAR. And we said, well, we can't really allow you to SSH into the instance. That's going to be problematic. So we came up with this idea, which is enhanced operating metrics, right? So we basically give you all these metrics, and you can get down to a 1 second granularity on them, right? And you can even pull this stuff via API because it's in our CloudWatch logs service. So any of these can be used to look at the system. And then the other cool one is that we actually do a process list like you have in top, right? And again, because this is API driven, you can actually look at this on a 1 second basis, like back in time for like days if you wanted to. So that's kind of interesting. And like here you can see I'm running a select query, for those of you probably in the front of the room. And it's using 3% of the overall box CPU, right? So, you know, if you have those kind of weird runaway ones where you're like, what's using the CPU? And you're like, oh, look, you know, Bob's running his select again. Oh, great. Sorry if there's a Bob in the room. Sorry. and then, of course, the nice thing is, of course, you know, people like graphs, a little easier to see. Let's say you have, you know, your boss goes and says, what happened there, man? Why did our CPU, you know, go off the wall? And you're like, well, I think someone might have started up a whole bunch of new processes accidentally, right? So it makes diagnostics a lot easier when you kind of see it in this kind of pane view. So our customers were really happy about this, but they said, well, that's all great, but what about my database? What about the queries running it? And that's where this new feature that we're doing called Performance Insights, or PI for short, is in beta along with the Aurora, or in preview, along with the Aurora Postgres. And that's where the first engine we're starting this on, but it's going to roll out across all our engines over time. And what it does is it really allows you to look at by weights, as you can see, SQL, host, or user, what's going on in your system. Has what statements are being run, you know, who's running them, where they're running them from. So, and we also look at things like capturing plan changes. So you'll be able to say, well, look, I had a spike. Oh, there's a plan change at that same time. That's the problem. Or, you know, these new machines fired up and they're starting to, you know, abuse the system by doing something, right? So, and this is just a different view of that where I'm just doing it by weights. So in this case, like I was running PG bench on a very small size scale one, right? Which causes a lot of contention on the smaller tables. And that's what, you know, you can see with these couple of weights showing, right? So we think this is going to be really helpful and, you know, we're going to be developing a lot of features in this area. So Aurora PostgreSQL. This is our multi-AZ product before Aurora. It was, you know, you had a primary, you have a multi-AZ secondary. It's not readable, it's cold, right? It's highly available because it's synchronous replication, cross two availability zones. We allowed you to have read replicas. And in some cases, people just use these if they don't have high availability requirements. But you can kind of add them for extra read scaling. And it's asynchronous. I mean, that's just standard Postgres streaming replication. And if you can divide your database up and your application so that you can, you know, do these eventually consistent reads, you can build this nicely scalable system. And we have a lot of customers that do this, and it works great. But customers asked us to basically improve on this, and that's part of the thing that we've done with Aurora Postgres. Because as much as this system works, you know, the primary fails, and you can fail over to the secondary, you notice there's only two copies, right? And some people say, look, my kind of industry, I need more protection than that. So, you know, this works. It does lots of good stuff. You can, you know, keep your read replicas up during upgrades. You can modify them. So you can build it to be highly available, but it's a little more complex than some of our customers liked. So with Aurora, it's a little different model. Essentially what you have, again, you have your application, you have like a database host that you connect to, but now we have storage that's distributed across three availability zones, and we do six copies. And it's a 4 of 6 synchronous writes model, and I'll get into the details on that. But as you can see, we just write to all of them at once. Now, this is an interesting problem because typically, I messed up my ordering. Okay. So for Aurora, what we do, we send these off all at the same time, and we start getting responses back. And as soon as we have four of them, we're basically finished. We don't have to wait for the other two to happen. Now, they do happen, but we get rid of a lot of jitter on this system. And to look at like what that looks like if you're not doing this model, this is an early test we did way back before starting Aurora, where we tried to look at what if we just made our multi-Z product write to more places. And so we compared sort of two nodes or two locations, really, from a network perspective, with four disk copies to a 3-location, 6-disk copy. Latency on the vertical axis, so smaller is better in this case. And you can see if you look at the percentiles of the query responses, or these are actually disk responses, you can see that we're like in the 6 to 7 milliseconds at the 50th percentile. So going to extra copies doesn't really hurt you there. But if you look at the far side at the 4.9, so 1 in 10,000 basically executions is getting a lot worse performance, almost a 4x degradation by adding this. And for every one of those queries that you miss, right? Like, so when you get one of those 123, it stops probably 20 of the little 6-millisecond ones from running, right? That's going to cause kind of problems with your application if you really need that kind of latency. So that's why we did a lot of different changes for Aurora. One of the other things that we did is we changed from something that had a log buffer to something that doesn't. And we don't do checkpointing. So here on the left side is sort of how Postgres or traditional databases work. As you're getting ready to commit work, right, you're just before you commit, right, you have all this queued work getting ready to go, you hit commit, and at that point, you enter the log buffer. What's cool about modern databases, it does group commit, allows multiple people into that buffer at once, so that you can actually get some concurrency. But if more work is getting ready to go, as soon as that log buffer starts getting ready to send down to the disk, you can't actually send more work in, right? So at that point, you're waiting for this stuff to go down to storage and to get acknowledged before you can say that's committed. And then the next piece of work can actually enter the log buffer. So you can see how this is going to cause your system to sort of move a little bit herky-jerky on the, you know, on its smoothness. On Aurora, it's a little different. What we have here is as things come in, work comes in to be committed, it just flows down in whatever order, whatever speed, we don't care. So we don't worry about the ordering on the top side. What we do is on the back side, we track what's durable. So in this case, we have this durability tracking, and basically there's all the little transactions over on the side. So when we get two of them in, we know we've gotten two acknowledgments out of the six, but the four we need. So once we get somebody to four, you can see I can send that commit back and say to the customer, that's good, right? But you'll notice that C I didn't say is acknowledged. Why is that? Because you still want your transactions to go in order, right? You don't want to be like, that guy that committed after me is being seen, but I'm not, right? Even though I committed before him. So since we need to wait for B to get to at least four before we say all of them are good, right? And again, you can see in this case, the last guy, E, is also not committed because D is not there. But what this allows us to do is to not have to worry about doing everything in an exact order, right? And this, again, changes the performance characteristics. So from an actual structural perspective, multiple AZs, you've got the application, you have your read-write node, and you're talking to this thing that I call Aurora Storage, right? So it's a layer that we talk to. It's got a lot of different machines in it spread across these three availability zones. And then you have 10 gig chunks of data that we stripe things over, and you end up with, you know, six copies. So that's trying to illustrate with the two colors, although I seem to, some of the colors look remarkably similar. But there is six there. And you can think of this sort of as a distributed storage system that allows us to repair and do all kinds of interesting stuff. For example, if this one 10 gig chunk, for example, was a replacement because that host died, or because it was just behind because of the 4 of 6 rule, we actually do gossiping between the nodes to do catch up, right? So there's multiple ways that we get you basically back to the correct state on your data. Now, we never commit it before it's 4 of 6, but to get you to 6 of 6, which is where we want you to be, right, we do all this other work. This allows you to have what we call replicas, but really are sort of read-only nodes in this model, right? And they don't have to spin up and have extra storage like I showed you in the current RDS model. So if you want 15 replicas today on RDS, you have 15 copies of the data plus your primary. In this, you have one copy of your data. I mean, it's 6-way copy, but one setup. And you can have 15 of these. But the interesting thing is we don't actually read from the storage to get to know where we are. We use an asynchronous invalidation and update method where we push over to the replicas and say, hey, you know, you, that block you have in memory has changed. You need to either get rid of it or update it. But the really neat feature is, let's say, has anyone ever done like a huge backfill on a replication system and had it go really horribly wrong? So, because if you go commit, let's say, a 10 gig change to your system, that has to flow through, even if nobody cared about it from an application perspective, right? It has to flow to your replica. In this model, we basically get to discard those, because if they're not in memory on the read-only node, we just say, oh, look, that's something we don't need to apply, because we've stored it in the disk already, right? It's in our central storage system. So this means we can have less lag and more performance because we're not doing unnecessary work on the replica that basically isn't benefiting the read-only node. The other thing that with Aurora that we do differently is we write less. So again, on the left side, sort of classic, Aurora on the right. So you have this block in memory, you have your wall. You go and let's say do an update. You're gonna end up touching a row that was the, you know, the original row. You're gonna basically delete and insert, right? So you end up with that. But because let's say it's the first time you've done it since you've checkpointed, you're going to get a full copy of that log or that block into your log, right? So that's actually a lot of writing, right, for making two or some very small updates. Now, the nice thing is when you update that block again, you only get like one little chunk in the wall, right? So we've already done quite a bit of writing. When the checkpoint comes around, we have to checkpoint that block out, right? And of course, we have to archive the wall. So that's a lot of work. On Aurora, when we do this, when we go do that update, those two changes, they basically get sent to Aurora storage as a log vector, just like sort of wall, and that's it. And the same thing when we do another one, that's all we do. So there's no archiving that happens on your system. There's no checkpointing. There's no full block logging to the wall stream because we don't need to do it because we don't have a split block problem. So this means that you can get more throughput out of the system, that and not having the log buffer as I showed before. So what does this look like in practice? Well, here's a PG bench doing, you know, its sort of initialized run, right? So you have the copy coming in, then vacuum and index build, and you can see that we have a copy in, we're a bit faster, but vacuum and index build where we can do some different things, mostly on the vacuum, this is a lot faster. One of the cool ones that I really liked, and I actually did this slide, so of course that's why I like it, is when you think about the trade-off between recovery and performance, right? So on a checkpoint-based system, the more work you allow to happen between a checkpoint, the less full wall blocks you're going to have to write, but it's the longer the recovery you're going to have. So what I'm showing up here is Aurora with no checkpoints was able to hit 92,000 writes per second. Now, these I constrained, except for this one, where I'm running as fast as I can. So I'm checkpointing at 12.5 gig. I'm only getting to 69,000 writes. My recovery time was 102 seconds. We don't have to do recovery. because we're a log-based structure. What comes back is already recovered, right? So there's no crash recovery in Aurora, so it's 1.2 seconds. And I have these two other examples to show you, like if you want to get down to a reasonable recovery rate, that's fine. But now look what it did to your throughput. By capping how much, you know, checkpointing size I had, that then cost me a lot of performance. So you used to have to make this decision between the two things of making, do I want to go fast or do I want to have, you know, more availability? So that's a change. This gets to the throughput case where I was talking about not doing as much work and not having the log buffer. We're able to sustain higher write rates than standard Postgres for longer and with more connections. This is similar, just a strictly, the other one was a read-write, this is just a write-only. And then again, as I was saying about that jitter, this is kind of an interesting one where this time it's response time, and again, lower is better. The yellow is Aurora, so you can see the consistency we're getting. Now, this is partially because of checkpoints, partially because of the log buffer. You can see that Postgres is bouncing around all over the place, right? So even though you might get some final number that says the average is X, it's not what you'd be experiencing if you were running an application on it. And this is what that looks like sort of drawn in a different way, right? You can see every one of those points is, you know, I was going on Postgres from anywhere between 5,000 and 30,000, depending on which second I'm looking at, versus a very much more consistent band. And then one of the other interesting ones that I didn't actually realize for quite a while about Postgres is this whole thing about having to do full pages written to the wall after a checkpoint. So if you can imagine, if you have a very small working set, the chance that you touch the same page over and over between one checkpoint, the chance you're going to hit the same page a lot, right? But let's say you go and have 10 terabytes and you're doing updates all over the place. The chance that you hit the same page becomes very small, which means every time you hit a page, you're doing a full write to the wall. This causes performance to decrease as you go larger with Postgres. So this one shows that, you know, with Aurora at 10 gig, there's a meaningful difference, but it's not huge. But when we start talking about, you know, 100 gig, this becomes quite a large difference where, you know, we're three times faster. And this actually just keeps sort of going up, you know, it slowly decreases where we don't get much faster, but it does, you know, as you go into the terabytes, it sort of has that problem. And with that, that's all I have on the presentation. I'm happy to take questions on any of this or anything else we do. There, in the back.
Are you releasing documentation on the log FTW? My good friend Google doesn't seem to know very much about it.
Well, that's because it's not being released till next week. That's why I had the word soon when I said when those were happening. Yeah, it will be in our standard documentation. It's essentially almost exactly what I did was what's in the documentation. I like to copy as much as I can. All those things that I talked about, they're going to be rolling out, I think, next week. So you should expect to see that then. Yeah. But I just thought, hey, I'm here. I'd rather tell you guys now about it instead of waiting another, you know, X months till another conference to announce it. So, other questions? In the back? When is Aurora going official? Well, it's officially in preview. We're working, you know, towards a date in the, you know, in the near future. I think we're, Kevin, what do we say?
We say
Q2, yeah. Sometime in Q2 is the goal, yeah. Yeah. He's reminding me since I'm on that development team, so yeah. Sorry, what was the? It's before Christmas, yes. You won't have to wait for Christmas to unwrap Aurora Postgres. Yes?
What will be the price difference?
The price for Aurora Postgres is going to be the same as our Aurora MySQL offering. So it's listed on the page. I don't actually look at the prices that much, so I can't tell you specifically in what region. So, but it'll be the same as, like, all the Aurora ones will be the same from a pricing family perspective. Other questions? Okay. Well, thank you very much.